So good morning. We'll start the session. I think a few more will join, and they may join as we go along. I'm Ramanshu Nailu. I work with Center for Sustainable Agriculture based out of Hyderabad, and we also work with farmers cooperatives across the country, and they market their produce as Sahaja, which is an organic brand owned by the farmer producer organizations. So this session will begin now, and I'll take about 45 minutes to 1 hour to share what I want to present. And in between, if you have any doubts, you can actually mention it in the chat box. Keep all your mics muted, and if you have any doubt, please type in the chat box. Second, if possible, I request all of you to switch off your video so that it will increase the bandwidth, so it will be more better. Since you can watch, so but you don't need to show yourself. And towards the end, when you have a question and answer session, then you can switch on your mic and video both together. Okay. So once again, I repeat, keep yourselves muted and switch off video. And in between, if you have doubts, please write in the chat box. I'll be regularly seeing that, and then I'll try to answer that in my presentation. And if you have any questions, keep towards the end and be brief in your question. Don't take it into conversations. So before we start, any clarifications you need? Hello? Fine.
No, so, sir, please proceed.
If there on this, if you have, if you want to ask anything. Okay, right. So in between, if you have any questions, please do share on the chat box. It will be easy for me to look into it and answer.
Sure, sir.
Once again, I welcome all of you from Center for Sustainable Agriculture and Sahaja Aharam and Grameen Academy. So in this product, we are going to, in this presentation, we are going to talk about organic food marketing. So there are three parts to the whole organic food marketing. One is about the product. So what product we are talking about, and then how do you call it? How do you name it? That's so. What is the product we are talking about? Second is the certification. So how do you label it? What are the rules, regulations? So that part of it. Third is the market. So how do you market? What are the strategies? How do you sell? So that's the third part of it. And I'll share our own experiences as well. So towards the end, we can make it into a conversation, but in between, I'll try to finish, because in the earlier session, there were too many questions, and then it became very difficult to take it to the logical end. And towards the end, we'll keep enough time and keep asking questions briefly. The current market, if you look at, there is a very big growth happening in organic market. Internationally, it is growing at 16%, while conventional products growth is around 10%. And India is the fastest growing organic market. It is around 25% compound growth rate, which India has registered. And many data show that next to 5 years, it will further increase. It will further increase, and then it would, the expansion in the next 5 years will be much more rapid. So one of the report which is released by Government of India and S Bank was that it says we may reach around 75,000 crores by 2025. In 2015, we were at 2,700 crores. So it's all, you can imagine the how many times it is going to be multiplied. So that's a growth potential for organic sector. And interestingly, compared to any other sector, I think food market is growing at a decent pace. And then within the food market, organic food is growing at a decent pace. So obviously, it is a good attractive position. Second is the highest number of organic producers are in India. So we have about 20 lakh organic producers and 699 processors, 669 exporters in all. And India ranks 9th in terms of organic area. So that's the current status. And in terms of organic export market, again, India has a great potential for becoming an organic exporter. And today it is around $515 million market, and it may increase significantly higher. And largely the exports are around US, Europe, Canada, Japan, West Asian markets. And India is one of the largest exporters of organic cotton too. It's not just food, but it's also cotton. India has the largest market, and a major share of the entire exports, if we take it, is wild collections also forms a significant component. Almost more than 60% of our exports are from wild collections. These wild collections are honey and herbal compounds. And so food market per se can grow very significantly. Till now, that growth is not exploited much. And why and all we'll discuss towards the end, but that's the great potential which we can see. And coming to the question, this is a significant question which everybody asks. What is actually organic food? What is organic product? Any food which is grown without using chemicals, without using growth hormones and antibiotics and GMOs, genetically modified organisms, can be called as organic product. And the stringent organic cultivation standards. So the organic standard which are defined, how you follow those standards and what is the means of verification of those standards. That's what makes a product to be labeled as organic. So as a product, any product which is produced without using chemicals, without using growth hormones, antibiotics and GMOs can be called as organic product. But the moment you want to sell in the market with a label, then you need to have a means of verification. So that means of verification is around what there is a regulatory system in this country. I think you see a difference between these two. So a product can be organic, but if you want to label it as organic and sell it in the market, there are certain guidelines around that. So we need to understand those guidelines based on which you can label your product as organic. And the production plots, collection centers, processing and packing facilities, and processing process itself all need to be organic. In the entire supply chain, whatever processes are involved, all need to be organic. Then only you can call a product as organic. For example, if you are growing sugar cane has to be grown organically. And if you make sugar or jaggery out of it, the sugar cane growing, sugar making process or a jaggery making process has to be organic. And if the sugar or jaggery is used to make a cookie, so both atta and jaggery need to be organic. So like that. So every product which you are using or every process you are using, every facility you are using, all need to be organic. And free from all these. So free from pesticides, free from fertilizers, free from growth hormones, free from antibiotics and genetically modified organisms. So if you look at actually the supply chain, from farmers to the final market, there are different stages and different steps, right? Say after the farmer produces it, there is an aggregation happens. So this aggregation can be a local attidar or anyone who does that aggregation, or it could be a farmer producer organizations. And after aggregation, there is a storage. And after the storage, there is a primary processing. Say paddy is converted into rice or wheat is converted. Wheat is cleaned, graded. Or if you take millets, the outer layer is removed. So like that. So whatever is a primary processing is done. And then primary product can be directly be sold. There is a wholesale or you can pack it for somebody else, which is called as white labeling. And from here, other buyers also can buy and manufacture new products which are ready to cook. Say somebody can buy wheat and make rava out of it, or can buy wheat, make atta, and then make a cookie out of it. So whatever product they want to make, it's a manufacturing. And from manufacturing, it goes for again bulk sales, because you can sell atta in bulk or cookies in bulk, or all of them, all you can sell as white labeled product, or pack and sell yourself directly to the retail market or to the international market. So in this entire supply chain, if you see, there are different stages and different stakeholders. And quality assurance is important at every stage. And as an organization, if you want to get into food business operations, you need to look into which part of the, which segment of the supply chain you want to be in. Either you want to be an aggregator and process and then sell it in the bulk market, or you want to buy from a bulk buyer and manufacture and sell. So this, which area you want to enter, you need to be clear and then make plans around that. Because each one of these, while you're looking at, it seems it's easy to look from, buy directly from farmer and then do export. In between steps, whatever are there, they also carry a lot of risk and cost. So you need, when you're making a business estimation, business plan, you need to make a very clear strategy around this one. So based on that is what your entire business operates. And across the supply chain, there are a number of rules, regulations which are there. If you are selling as a farmer directly to the consumer, you are exempted from any of these things. So you are not regulated as long as you are selling as a farmer, and as long as you are not packing it. As long as you are selling as a farmer, as long as you are not packing it, you are exempted. But the moment it gets into packing, then or labeling, then it starts getting under the regulation. So we need to understand what regulation operates as well, apart from the business plan per se. And coming to the practices of production, crop production, basically, there are a number of approaches to make to farming. So organic farming, natural farming, the Subhash Palek, ZBNF, what they call as zero budget natural farming, or which is renamed as a Subhash Palekar natural farming now, or biodynamic farming, permaculture. So any of these approaches which are not using chemicals and which are not using antibiotics and any of these synthetic chemicals, and also in terms of GMOs, not using GMOs, all of them are qualified to be called as organic production practices. And all these rules comes under organic certification. We'll come to that. And currently, there were you might have heard there is a lot of controversy in the country going on between organic, natural, super, ZBNF and all. Legally speaking, all of them are qualified to be called as organic. All of them are qualified as to be called as organic. What is called as natural is what you collect from the nature. Say, if you are collecting from forest, honey you are collecting from forest, or you are collecting medicinal and aromatic plants, they are called as natural. Otherwise, all are called organic. And Government of India has come up with a new definition by combining all these practices. They call it as Bharatiya Prakriti Krishi Paddhati, BPKP. And in English, it reads as Indian Natural Farming Practices. So any of these practices you follow, it can still be called as organic. So no difference between any of these practices. And in terms of public policy support, Government of India has several policies to support. So Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana is one of the major flagship program of the Government of India, where across the country, organic farmers are supported. Similarly, Mission for Integrated Development of Horticulture, National Mission for Sustainable Agriculture, Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana, all of them have components of organic farming. Similarly, Rashtriya Krishi, similarly, 10 states have organic farming policies, but many of them do not have a roadmap of converting farmers into organic. So they simply have a policy, but never made an attempt to take it into an action. But there are three states where some attempt has been made, AP, Karnataka, Himachal Pradesh, and to an extent Kerala. They started supporting farmers, and then Gujarat also recently started some initiative where they started directly supporting farmers to convert to organic. And in the Northeast region, there is a mission on organic value chain development, which again is focused on developing organic value chains in the Northeast India. And Sikkim, Nagaland became the states which have become fully organic. So across the country, these are the support schemes which one can use to move towards organic. And several questions came up about certification. And we'll go through the details of certification. I'm getting some questions. If you have any questions, please do write in the chat box so that I can keep answering them. See, quality assurance is about whatever claim we are making on a product, how it can be verified, how you can assure that the quality which you are claiming is organic or whatever you are calling it. So as a growth in the organic market is increasing, and as the volumes are increasing and the distance between producers and consumers is increasing, you need some independent way of verifying these things. So that's where actually the certification process comes in. A guarantee that whatever you are claiming is true. And in India, we have two kinds of certification. One is called NPOP, National Program for Organic Promotion. And this is a third party verification system where the claim, whatever you made, is verified by a third party. And you manage the data, and then it will be verified and a certificate is issued. And NPOP standards are notified, and you can see the NPOP standards available on the Government of India websites. And if you want, I can share those systems as well. Second system is introduced in India. It is called as a participatory guarantee system, where a group of farmers can come and maintain their records, and then there will be a regional council which is identified, which can verify and then issue a certificate. So there is a slight variance between third-party system and PGS system. We'll discuss about it. So these are the two certification systems currently operated in India. They are approved by Government of India. And internationally, every country has its own standards. So USDA has its own standards, EU has its own standards, and Australia has its own standards, Middle East has their own standards. So everybody has their own standards. And in 2013, there is an effort began to harmonize all these standards. Some standards are harmonized, some are not. Say, for example, if you take USDA standards and NPOP standards, both are harmonized. So when you, if you have an NPOP certificate, you can ask for issuing NOP as well. So it's the same data. You can also get NOP certificate, which is equivalent to the USDA one. So if you want to export to US, you can use the same certificate and then do that. So that's the basic certification systems available in India. And if you look at rules in India, Food Safety Standards Authority of India in 2017 has come up with the labeling standards first time to make organic food regulated. And this law says all organic food sold in India will be certified and labeled as per the NPOP or PGS standards. So either of it is mandatory. It's you cannot sell anything without NPOP or PGS standards in this country. So that's what this 2017 law says. And how consumer verifies it. So consumer verifies through a label basically, which is on the packet. So certification label is mandatory on products which you claim to be organic. Mm-hmm. And this cannot be a sticker. It should be a printed label. printed label means the cover has to be printed. Then only you can call it as an organic certification and or the certified organic product. And there are when you call it as organic on label, there are different ways of understanding this. One, if it is a single ingredient product. Single ingredient product means, say, you have wheat or you have rice, you have dal, so that kind of. And you can only label it as organic if you follow all specified standards. Then only you can call it as organic. Otherwise, you cannot call it as organic. Second, there are multi-ingredient products, like, say, cookies are there. Like, otherwise, you have pasta or you have noodles or you may make any other product. And all these products can be labeled as organic only if you have more than 95% of ingredients or of certified origin. Then only you can label it as organic. And this 95% of ingredients is by weight. And if you have some products which are organic and some products which are not organic, the 70%, up to 70% ingredients are organic, then you can label it as made with organic. And you need to specify in the ingredient which products are organic and which products are not organic. That you need to specify in the ingredients, but you will be allowed to sell them as organic, but made with organic ingredients is what you need to write. And another category is if you have less than 70% ingredients as organic, you cannot label the product as organic, but in the ingredients you can mention saying this ingredient is organic. For example, many times what happens is among the ingredients you use, one or two ingredients may be the most crucial ones. So for example, chili powder, what happens in the chili life cycle is, in the entire life cycle, chilies are never washed. Red chilies are never washed. So the pesticide residues would be carried forward into the chilies. So people are more concerned about chilies than any other product. So if you are using chili powder, organic chili powder in your product, all others may be raw, naturally collected or ingredients which have lesser or low pesticide use. So you can mention saying the chilies used are organic. So like that. After the rules are announced in 2017, Government of India also gave exemptions till 1st April 2020. And so you can see that this 1st April 2020 got locked up in the lockdown period. So there is a discussion that all rules which are supposed to be implemented during the lockdown period will be extended till September. So this also probably is got extended. So there is no explicit announcement, but you can take it that it can go up to September. So small original producer or producer organization with annual turnover not exceeding 12 lakhs is exempted. See that. That's something which is very important. There are a few terminology in this. Small original producer or a producer organization with annual turnover not exceeding 12 lakhs per annum, they can sell. Which means some farmer who is producing vegetables or someone who is producing grains, if they are able to sell directly to the consumers, they can sell directly and there is no need to have a certification if they can sell directly. And the same rule applies to the producer organization. So up to 12 lakh rupees, even a producer organization can sell directly. There is no need to have any certification. They are exempted. They don't need to get certification. Aggregators and intermediaries that may not have organic produce sales turnover over 50 lakhs are also exempted, but they cannot use Jaivik Bharat logo. We'll come to this logos story later. Aggregators or intermediaries also are exempted up to 50 lakh annual sales till April 1st. So obviously it will be for a few more months kind of thing. And if you are importing product from other countries, the imports of organic food from other countries which have a bilateral equivalence agreement, you can use it and you don't need to get recertified. So for example, like I said, if it is NPOP certified, you can sell to America. You can also procure any product from US if it is certified in US and sell with the same label in India. So that's what it says. And say, for example, if you take examples, how this operates, let's look at a few examples. Say if a farmer, A is a farmer who produces paddy, and B is an organic brand which sells organic rice, and C is a bakery which makes organic cookies. A as a farmer is exempted to sell paddy directly or rice directly up to 12 lakh rupees. Farmer is exempted to sell. If B has to buy from A farmer, B has to have organic certification, and B has to get the organic certificate from A. So obviously, if A doesn't have a certificate, B cannot use it. So A need to be organically certified. If he has to sell to A, another organic brand. So he's exempted only if he has to sell directly. And if he's selling to an organic brand, he's not exempted. And so A can be a member of a local PGS group or a farmer producer company. Certificate can be in the name of farmer or a producer company or anyone who operates. So anyone can take this organic certification for production. B can buy paddy from A and process in their own processing facility or get processed in another certified organic facility. So they cannot process in regular organic regular facility, but they can only get processed in another organic processing facility. So either they should own a such a processing facility or they should get it processed only in another certified organic processing facility. Alternatively, they can actually buy a processed rice from the farmer if farmer has both production and processing certificate. And so the certificate transfer to B would be as rice. So if B is buying paddy, then he has to produce a certificate showing where they got the processing done. Then only they can sell rice. If they are buying rice, then they will get a certificate from the farmer or farmer producer company that it is a rice which B bought. And so B can sell rice. So that's the difference between the two. And say C is a bakery which makes organic cookies. And so C can buy rice from B and make atta, or buy atta directly from B. So both are possible. They may buy sugar or jaggery for someone else, but that company or that organization, that individual who sells the sugar or jaggery also need to be certified. So all these certificates are pooled in the name of C. And if Y is a store which sells products from A, B or C, they don't need to have a certificate as long as the store is not labeled as organic. But they should have a separate racks for conventional products as well as organic products. If Z is a food business operator who doesn't own production nor own a processing facility, they can still do the organic business. So they can buy from A or B or C any product and get it labeled by their own name. So their label has to get the certificate. So this is a way certification operates. Okay. And Food Safety Standards Authority of India is the regulatory body for taking action on irregularities in the organic or any other food labeling system. So any food related irregularities are regulated by government of India through Food Safety Standards Authority of India. And the certification, if you take the organic certification, this is basically a tool that informs organic integrity. There are different certificates which you can see here. There are different labels also. So when consumer wants to buy an organic product which is environmentally friendly and then safer for consumption, their understanding comes from the certificate and then the label, because they don't know who has produced it. They cannot verify the farmer, so they will go by the label. And maintaining the integrity of the label is the responsibility of the organization which is maintaining it. Say for example, there are certification agencies, there could be 10 or 15 certification agencies, and hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, sorry, there was some problem in between. Sorry, network. There was some network problem. Okay. Yeah. Coming back to the question of certification. So the certificate is the critical one. So maintaining the quality of the certificate, the integrity of the certificate is the responsibility of the people involved in the certification process. So both in terms of the organization which gives the certificate and the body which certifies, both has the responsibility to maintain the integrity. So when we are talking about third party certificate, it's an agency which gives certificate also has to maintain, and the accredited agency also has to follow the norms in terms of following and regulating the certification bodies. So in India, we have a PGS and NPOP certificate, and Government of India, after issuing these rules under 2017 FSSAI Act, they brought in a common certificate called as Jaivik Bharat. So this Jaivik Bharat is the new organic logo of India, which covers both third party certificate as well as PGS India. So this is an important thing which we all need to understand. First time in the world, India brought both PGS as well as third party certifications under the equal platform. So either you are third party certified or PGS India organic, both have to use the Jaivik Bharat logo only. So once you use Jaivik Bharat logo, you are certified organic under as per the FSSAI standards. Apart from this, there are also private initiatives, private labels is what we call. So there is a PGS Organic Council in India, which is started by Organic Farmers Association of India. In fact, this started much before PGS India started. And PGS Council is a private label, not yet approved by Government of India, but there are discussions going on. Apart from third party verification and PGS India organic, there should be private labels also should be allowed. So probably after the lockdown, a decision on this may be taken. There is also another private label which is called as Zero. And this is for pesticide or residue free produce. So the way they operate is they check the residues and then they label it. So they don't claim it as organic, but they say free. So this is also a private label which is under operation. And there is apart from organic certification, there are also issues like carbon footprints and also about fair trade, so that the benefit generated in the supply chain are equally shared between all the players. So it is called fair trade label. So there's a fair trade label also available. And as an organization, we are working on a new labeling, which is called as ecological footprints, to measure the carbon footprints and labeling it. So this is what one of the effort which we are also trying. So there could be various certificates and labels which a food product will carry. And when it comes to the NPOP certification, so there are 28 accredited bodies under NPOP, the third party certification, and there are few state certification agencies also. So Telangana certification agency is there, Telangana organic certification agency, Uttarakhand organic certification agency, Odisha has an organic certification agency. And one of the common issue about this organic this certification agencies is that it's very quite expensive. Many people raise this issue, and this was the state certification agencies do it at a less expensive process. So say Telangana organic certification agency charges much lower compared to any other certification agencies. But we also need to remember the certification agencies also carry a value. Carry a value. So it depends on which agency you are taking. The quality also depends on which agency you are getting your certificate from. Because say you may pass out as an engineer from any college, but the value of the degree depends on the university which gave you. So that's something which is very, very important. And what is certified? If you look at what is certified, it's actually the farm plots. Farm plots are certified annually, and products grown in the plots for that year will get a certificate. So you get a certificate. Say if you have 2 acres of land under organic certification, and if you are growing millets, then you get for that particular season to sell the amount of the quantity of produce which you can produce in that particular plot. That's all. So that's how organic certification works. So the plot is certified, and you need to keep that plot organic forever. Then only it works. And processing facilities also need to be certified, and it should be exclusive organic. It should be exclusive organic. And food business operators also can get their certificate. And so farm plots, processing, and food business operators. These three needs to get the certificate. The certificate is available for individual or a group. So at a group level, if you take a certificate, the entire group need to be organic. And if any one is found to be defaulting, entire group loses the certificate. And the cost depends on number of locations where farmers and farmer groups are there. And the shelf life of the products which you can sell is 1 year. So the certificate is valid for one season. So whatever product you are producing this year, it will be valid for the next one season to sell. So 1 year you can sell that product. Say if you are buying rice, you can sell that rice for next 1 year. So if otherwise, then next year when you are getting your certificate renewed, then you need to add the earlier one. Carry forward, you need to show, and then add that into your next year one. And one can get a certificate from both the agencies. Multiple agencies is quite possible, but it becomes expensive. Depends on why you need from multiple agencies. So for example, if you are to sell in Europe, many of the European brands ask for a Demeter certificate. Demeter is a biodynamic certificate, agency's certificate. So in addition to NPOP certificate, people also take Demeter certificate to sell in Europe. So that's how you can go for multiple certificates as well. All these certifications are 3 years process. So 2 years you get a certificate saying you are under conversion. So during that period, you cannot sell, label it as organic, but you are allowed to sell, but you cannot label it as organic, you can sell. So the second system is called participatory guarantee system. Basically, participatory guarantee systems are built on shared vision and shared ideas. And currently in India, PGS is available for crops and orchards, beekeeping, livestock, wild harvest, processing and handling. And here this processing and handling is only restricted to farmers. So if there is a PGS farmer, if they want to process any produce, so that unit can be certified for the period for which there is a processing going on. So an independent processing facility cannot get a PGS certification. A farmer who want to process can get that PGS certification. So whether it is a traditional processing facility or a modern processing facility, to the period for which they are processing, they can get a process certification as well. And NCOF is a nodal body which governs the rules and regulations of participatory guarantee system. And they identify and accredit PGS regional councils. Currently in India, there are 327 PGS regional councils, and they issue, verify and issue certificate to local groups. So local groups are the farmer groups which are organized into 5 to 15 members as a group, and this group gets a certificate. So any one of them violates, entire group is a default, and then it will. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the PGS system, it's only the group which can get. So under third party system, you can get individually, you can get certificate. But under PGS, it's only the group. It's not, individuals are not allowed to have certificate under PGS. And a PGS India certificate is also equivalent to the third party system. Third party certification, it is transferable. So when you are selling the product, you transfer the certificate along with that. And PGS certification also, like the third party certification, is traceable up to the farmer level. So when it comes to the labeling, so there are four labels any packet carries. So the primary display panel is the first you see here. So this is the primary display panel. And this is a information panel, and this is the ingredients panel, and this is the other panel. So in all these areas, whatever you are using is what is governed by the labeling law. So that labeling law is what the USDA law says, or in India, FSSAI says. So if you are claiming as natural 100% product, then you need to have a verification means of it. Okay. And similarly, when you are writing here as natural or organic, both are governed under the same law. So it should be labeled only if you have the ingredients all as 100% verifiable, certified organic. Then only you can make a claim. Otherwise, you cannot make a claim. There is a question: if a farmer wants to apply for his processing facility under PGS certification, then does he needs to apply for his produce as well as he can purchase raw material from a certified seller and do the processing? No. If you are process buying and selling, then you get regulated under FSSAI law. If it is your produce which you are processing and you are a certified PGS farmer, then you can do it. That's all. There is no separate law for natural products. Organic or natural is governed under the same law. So it is interchangeably used. Minimum is 1 acre. To get certified under PGS or NPOP certification, minimum is 1 acre. There is no maximum law. And so apart from this, there are individual requirements to setting up a business enterprise. So either you can set it up as an individual, sole proprietorship, partnership, one person company, limited liability company, private limited company, public limited company. So in fact, producer company comes under private limited company rules only. So any of these can set up any of these businesses. There is no separate thing called as certified natural in India or globally. It's the same rules which apply. And you can mention So it will be a natural collection. So it's a, it comes under the wild collections. So once you have a body which is an entity, so you can be an individual or a company, and you need a space, and then you need licenses like trade license, shops and established licenses, and FSSA license. And then in FSSA license, there are two kinds of licenses, three actually. One is a central license, if you have a turnover of more than 20 crores, so across the country you can get one-time license. State licenses for businesses between 12 to 20 crores, and anything less than 12 crores needs individual location, you need an FSSA license. For example, I have four processing facilities. My four processing facilities should have independent FSSA license if I am not above 12 crore turnover. So that's a state license means. And petty food manufacturers with less than 12 lakh turnover and have a capacity to manufacture less than 100 kg per day or temporary vendors, all these are exempted from FSSA license. And GST is another one which is registered. Do we need PGS renew every year? Yes, both third party certification and NPOP need to be certified every year. So because your crop changes, your product changes, so every year you need to change and get your certificate. So sourcing your produce, where do you source your produce? So you can only source your produce if you are into a, if you are into a food business operator, you can source from certified organic farmers or certified FPOs. So FPO may have certification on its name or the individual farmers. So whatever may be the means, you can use both of them. Or you can buy from bulk vendors as well. If they have certified organic produce and they can transfer the certificate to you. So all this is quite possible. So how do you source? So let's discuss about this sourcing. And in India, there are two aggregating things which started, if you can look at. So all the PGS farmers data is now available on Jaivik Kheti. Jaivikkheti.in is a website which NCOF maintains. There is also a mobile application where you can buy the produce directly from the farmers. So whoever got certified under PGS, all are available under Jaivik Kheti on the portal, where you can get the produce. So you can look at the Jaivik Kheti portal and then directly contact the farmer group and then buy from them. This is one portal which is available. Second is Organic Mandi, which we started, CSA started as during this crisis when farmers were unable to sell. These are all both ICS as well as PGS farmers. So the organic produce which is available with the farmers is listed here. You can directly contact the farmer producer organization and then make an agreement with them and then source them. And whenever you are buying the produce, the certificate would be transferred to you. So that's a so organic mandi. So apart from these two, there are no other aggregating platforms or genuine marketplaces where organic produce is available. So if you are interested, you all can join and build Organic Mandi as an organic market platform. Currently, we also have a list of organic processors available, organic buyers available. So all that is available as part of this Organic Mandi thing. And the key challenges in this is everyone wants to be across the supply chain, which is the most difficult part. So almost if you take organic brands in the country, 98% of them are across the supply chain. So the moment you are across the supply chain, you cannot increase your volumes. So you need to figure out where your strength lies and work only at that part of the supply chain and partner with others in the other players in the supply chain. Then only it will be profitable. If you want to be across the supply chain, you are not only aggregating the profits, you are also aggregating the risk and cost. So that you need to remember very well. Agri-produce is seasonal, so holding is very important. Say for example, if you take rice, you need to hold it for 16 to 18 months. Before you sell, start selling. So, which is quite expensive. So, your storage costs and the interest on the working capital which got locked up will be very huge. So, raw produce, particularly the grains and all, are becoming very expensive because of that. And there is no organized bulk vendor where this produce can be stored and then you can buy rice every month. There's no such mechanism available in this country. So you need to buy for the entire year and hold it yourself. That's the biggest problem here. So probably creating such facilities and getting into that business is something which is important. And certainly FPOs becomes a good platform for doing that. Perishability of fruits and vegetables without much storage value is a problem. Storage value here means, say, tomato prices have gone down significantly low now, but there is no value in storing them. So if you store tomatoes for, say, 1 month, the cost of storage is not equivalent to the price increase which you get. So unfortunately, there is no storage value for any of these things. Only value addition can help. But value-added products market is very different. So raw produce market is very different. So you need to look at where you want to get into. Similarly, FPOs can do the storage and the products. They can do as a bulk vendors. But unfortunate problem is they don't have access to the working capital. Currently, the banking rules and all are asking for non-agricultural assets as collateral. So, collateral-free capital is not available for the FPOs. So, that's how FPOs are unable to procure the produce. And a lack of processing facilities, storage facilities, particularly organic, is a serious problem. So, what happens? I buy paddy from Kurnool. There is no certified organic facility there. So obviously I have to take it to somewhere in Vishakhapatnam where there is a organic processing facility. So I process it there, but there is no storage facility there. So I bring back to Hyderabad and then store in Hyderabad, pack, and then I sell in Mumbai. So you can imagine the logistics which all these are there. So we need to figure out how these processing facilities, storage facilities can be created. It could be a network of organizations which can do that. And currently there is no government agency which will buy or store. So though there are facilities like warehouse receipt scheme available, say you can store and then take a loan on that as a farmer. There are no organically stored warehouses. So all warehouses spray pesticides. So you cannot store your produce in any of the regular warehouses. And there is no organic warehouses in this country. So obviously, those certain schemes are available. We are unable to make use of any of these schemes. Unfortunately, there are single set of standards for all. We can actually have a graded standards. Like for example, if there is only one store, why should I sell only in one store? Why should I be governed with the same set of rules with someone who has 100 stores in the country? And I sell, say, small amounts and in a very local area, like say I come from Chhattisgarh and then I sell only in the particular district. So why should I have a stringent rules imposed on me as someone who is selling across the country? So there's no need. So we can actually have a different set of standards. And unfortunately, the exemptions which are available to individuals cannot be aggregated at an FPO level. Say individual is exempted up to 12 lakh rupees, like I said, but FPO is not allowed to sell more than 12 lakhs. So even if as an FPO or an individual, you cannot do more than that. So the better way for an FPO is to aggregate all the exemptions. So it can create a market place rather than a brand. So the marketplace can have a brand. It need not be food brand. So I can have a marketplace where any farmer can come and sell, and each farmer can sell up to 12 lakh rupees. And in India, as you know, the average income of farmers is less than 5 lakh rupees. So I don't think anybody will cross 12 lakh rupees. Even if they cross 12 lakh rupees, there is no issue. They can obviously get into the conventional market, the certification process. So it's much easy to operate that way. So a market platforms is what probably FPOs should look at creating that. So coming to the our experiences, so we have a brand called Sahaja Aram. This is a federation of farmer cooperatives. So these are the stores which are run by Sahaja Aram. We have in Hyderabad, Visakhapatnam, and we sell directly to consumers. And this is a farmer-owned producer cooperatives federation. And this brand is owned by the producer company. This is a federation of producer cooperatives. And they sell through exhibitions, they sell through direct stores. So these are all the stores which sell these produce. We also sell through mobile vans, where mobile van goes to different areas and then mobile van sells this produce. And we also help farmers to sell directly. So these are all, you can see different designs of vans where farmer can go directly and sell to the consumers. So we designed a staggered production of vegetable model where farmer can get weekly harvest of 2000 rupees worth vegetables, irrespective of what vegetable it is. It's about 2000 rupees worth vegetables which they can get from half an acre plot. So around the year 365 days they can grow. So 52 harvests is what a farmer gets, and then 52 times farmer can harvest the vegetables. So this is a model where we are trying out this, where farmers can sell directly. So this is a quality assurance center. So collection, grading, and transportation is done at the collection centers. So these collection centers need to be certified. These collection centers need to be certified. And we have processing facilities aggregated level, so not at individual farmer cooperative level. So we have four food hubs, one in Warangal, one in Vijayanagaram, one in Karnool, and another is in Wardha in Maharashtra. So all these places we have processing storage facilities. So farmers get their produce and then they store here. And this is a millet processing unit in Boddam. So just to show you some examples, say this is an onion storage facility. This is oil producing. This is a pulse processing. This is a solar dryer. This is a, what you see below is a bakery. So all these are products which are made. What you see here is a solar dried vegetables which are used for dice. So it's a food dice. So palak, beetroot, all are used to make dice. And these are cookies, pickles, and various other products which you can see here. And our products are certified both under PGS India Organic as well as third party certification. So both we have. And we also have quality management certificates like ISO 9000. And we also have this ecological footprint label, which is developed, where you can measure you can quantify the water footprint, carbon footprint, energy footprint, as well as the food miles the food has traveled before it reaches the plate of the consumer. We are also trying to quantify the economic benefit farmer gets from the consumer's purchase. So there is a QR code which is put onto the packets, the labels, where you can label and then you can see how much of what you pay goes to the consumer. So these are all additional ways of adding value to your product. And CSA is also a PGS regional council. So we also provide organic certification under PGS India. And we certify only groups, and each group can be of 10 to 20 people. And the certification is offered for crops, orchard production, livestock, beekeeping, wild collections, processing and handling. So we are allowed for across the country. So we are a certified body accredited for all the states in the country. And what you see here is a PGS mobile application which we have developed. You can download it from the Google Play, and each of these product can be traced back. It can be traced back to the producer group which has produced it. And from the mobile application, you can also not only trace back, but you can also see what are the quality standards available. And then if you are a farmer group, you can maintain your data as well. So all these are available under this thing. And in addition, we have several mobile applications which we have developed for benefit of the farmers. One is called as a Pestoscope, where farmer can identify the pests and diseases, and then you can download that. It is available now. And Organic Mandi, I already told, it is available. There are websites for all these info, all these also. And we have traceability for all these products, whatever we are selling. And Organic Mandi is in operation. Basically, you can go and check the products which are available. So sorry, here in this slide, I couldn't remove this one. It is already under implementation. And we also run regular training programs, both on production, processing, marketing, as well as several parts of the supply chain. And so we call it as a Grameen Academy. And there are several online courses which are going to come up. So these are some of the free engagements we do, but we also have a paid courses where we do it live as well as we do it online. So there are the campus-based training programs where several people across the country regularly come. So we regularly announce, it's in Hyderabad. So Grameen Academy is in Hyderabad. We also do off-campus trainings across the country. So I stop here and then let's have questions. So these are our contacts, both emails as well as phone numbers. So you can always get back to us. So before you all can pull up your questions, I have some questions here which came from others. Is there a label for natural products? No, it is the same organic certification which is applicable for both. And minimum area is, I already told, it is 1 acre, and maximum is not available. Maximum is not there. And what is the vision for India for organic agriculture? There's a lot of discussions going on. Yeah, very sorry. So this internet seems to be a problem today. Yeah, so when we are actually trying to look at this, the questions. Yeah, now I can take the questions. Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sir, myself, Narendra Kumar, sir. Can you just explain the significance of residue-free certificates, sir, from agencies like SGS Private Limited and all? If, for example, if a product scores negative 200 or 300 residues, can that be considered or organic, or how is it, sir?
No. See, organic labeling very clearly talks about only it, if it is certified organic.
Okay.
So you can claim it as residue free.
Okay, sir.
See, residue free is different from certified organic.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hi, sir. This is Shanti Kumar. Yeah, so as a family, actually, we just got into organic farming just about 1 or 1.5 years back. Mm-hmm. So we want to do, let's say, a polyculture of fruit orchard, mixed plantation. So what I was thinking is, let's say probably if we start in 4 or 5 acres to start with, so can we focus on exports, let's say, exporting this fruit produce? Is that scale enough? What is your view?
See, exports, if you are looking at, say one container is the minimum size of a container is about 20 tons. Then it becomes difficult for you. So you have to share with other containers. then other container also has to be organic. So those difficulties comes in. And then transportation costs, if you look at, so all that matters, no?
Okay, sir. Yeah.
So volume matters actually.
Right. So instead of that, probably can we create like value-added products, like probably fruit jams or.
You can do that.
What do you suggest?
Yeah. See, always value-added products has a better market. But you need to think of if you are talking about exports, can you sell so much of value-added product?
No. Value-added product, you probably hear itself, not.
That's what I'm saying. Say here, then you need to sell to many other stores through other stores. So your business model would be in terms of buying organic fruits, make a product, and then sell product.
Yeah, distribution. I think distribution would be the
key. So now e-commerce portals are there, and then several other organic brands are there. So you can do both in terms of white labeling as well as branded product. Both you can do.
Okay. So for that, okay, fine. Okay, got it.
Yeah.
Hello.
Huh.
Sir, good morning, sir. This is regarding organic cotton. Sorry if I'm on to a different topic. Cotton.
Gany? Hello?
Cotton, sir. Yeah. Cotton.
Cotton.
Hello. Yes, okay. Sir. Cotton.
We'll come to the cotton. Yeah, we'll come to the cotton. This is one question. What is the optimum logistic solution for 500 to 600 kg from south to Delhi? So if it is about grains, half a quintal makes no big... it may not be of much use. It may add too much cost. Best is to sell through courier or rail. Both are available. Yeah. So pulses, if you are buying, so it adds something like 500 to say, so per kg, it may add about 15 rupees or so, 15 to 16 rupees. Yeah. Somebody is asking for cotton. Yeah. See, if you're interested in cotton, do message me separately. I can talk to you separately because we are doing one more on organic cotton supply chain. We work on organic cotton supply chain. So we can take a separate session. We are actually doing a separate session on that. We are trying to bring different players on a platform. So that's something to discuss. But the similar rules applies to organic cotton as well.
Sir, where should I write? Should I write to on your
email? You can email me. You can email me.
Okay.
You have my email ID, right? I've sent you.
I'm not sure, sir. I'll check your slide because you have sent the contact.
Yeah. You can check the slide or the mail which was sent to you as the email. No, you can reply back.
Okay. Sure. Thank you.
Grameen Academy email.
Grameen Academy. Yeah. So if any one of you are further interested in continuing this conversation, because the whole attempt is to build an ecosystem where the supplies can be improved. See, from as a group, we work with farmers. So our interest is more about creating market for farmers. So more farmers, if they are able to sell their produce, it is good for us. So that's what our whole intention is. So we want to build that kind of ecosystem where more people can buy from the farmers. So that's an attempt. So if you are interested to further taking this conversation forward, you want to be part of the ecosystem, do write to us. We will discuss with you separately.
Sir, one question. No?
Sir, yeah. I've asked you one question on the chat.
Can you say if I missed it?
Yeah. So on chat, sir, I've just mentioned one question. So I have a 3 acres farm where I'm growing lemons organically. It's not yet bearing fruit, but in the next 2 years, maybe it would. And by then, my PGS certification will also come through.
Okay. So if you want to sell them as organic, now you should get it certified.
Yeah. No, that's in process. That's in process. My PGS certification is process. What I'm saying is, you know, lemon is something which is like not that costly stuff, right?
So selling lemon makes no sense. So either you have to sell lemon juice or you have to make... lemon pickle.
Okay.
So several products we can make. So they will have a shelf life as well as.
But just selling plain lemon.
Just selling lemon makes no sense. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
So we have courses on food processing as well. So if you are interested, you can subscribe to them.
Are there any? Hi, sir. Are there any chances that a single farmer can also get certification? Because it's not practically possible for
Under PGS, it is not possible. Under PGS, it is not possible. But under third-party certification, you can get. But it will be pretty expensive. So you have to bear the cost of what goes for, say, 500 farmers. So say typically, the way third-party certification works is one certificate has a cost. So it can be shared by 100 farmers, 200 farmers, up to 500 acres, you can share. So the cost would be the same, whether you are a one farmer or a 500 farmers. So that's what is the issue. So it will not be economical. So what would be economical is to get people together. Okay. So the basic requirement for the PGS certification is having a group, which is fully organic.
Okay. And can a single farmer sell their produce on the organic mandi, the website that you have created?
They can.
They can.
Right? We are trying to engage, we are trying to encourage only farmer groups and producer organizations. But if there are single farmer, obviously we can help.
Hi, Ramu.
Okay. Hi.
Ramu, the very interesting example you shared about A, B, C, and Z.
Yeah.
So that as a food business operator, if he gets into organic certification, what does he get certified upon?
So the brand is certified.
So who basically gives the certification to them?
So there's a certification agency. Mm-hmm. Say, for example, you have an Ashwini Organics.
Right.
So you register Ashwini Organics with someone. Then what you need to get, what is verified is, if you are buying from Sahaja Aram and processing yourself, so your processing facility will be verified.
Okay, so any one of the functions which I intend to carry for an organic product, I need to be certified on that.
Yes. So if you are only buying all packet products from others and selling, then only your records will be verified.
Lovely. Thank you. Thank you, Ram.
Yeah, Ramu, this is Sudhir, and as you said, that the product is testable at farmer level.
Yes.
PGS.
Yes.
So, should the farmer has to adopt the technology for traceability, or how it has? How
no.
It
no. For the moment farmer registers, the farmer plot data is taken.
Okay.
And when the certificate is issued, it is issued in the name of the farmer. Farmer group. So, farmer group will have all the farmers' names and then their details. So you can trace back there.
But as I know that there should be a QR code to trace all this.
Yes. So certificate data carries a QR code.
No, but if I sold the same product to another brand, then he may paste.
So that will be transferred. So that will be transferred. See, you can only trace up to the next person who has produced it. Say, for example, if you are buying a product from, say, earlier example, Ashwini Organics.
Okay.
If Ashwini Organics bought from 10 locations, you will get is your traceability goes up to the Ashwini Organics. And from which farmer group, which certificate, who are the 10 suppliers for Ashwini Organics is what you can see. Then you can go back and then you need to verify that also.
Okay.
So the shorter supply chains, say, if you're buying from Sahaja Aram, you can directly trace the farmer group. So that's the difference, basically.
Hi, sir. This is Shilpa. I have a question. As you said about Harmony certification, like we apply for MPOP, we can also get it for USDA.
Yeah.
So in the same way, can we apply for PGS India and EPEDA?
No, see, PGS India one, the once you have a PGS India certificate, no, that cannot be sold in, that is not equivalent to USDA certificate.
Okay.
But somebody who has a USDA certificate is a processor, a retailer, they buy from you, process, and then sell, they can do. So you have to get a FBO license is not given by, FBO certificate is not given by PGS India. PGS India gives only organic farmer certificate.
Farmer certificate, yes.
So farmer, so food business operator certificate you get from a third party verification anyway.
Okay. Okay.
You can buy from the PGS and then use the certificate which you have as FBO to sell.
Okay. So one more question. For example, if the farmers are not located in a particular village, or they belong to one district, they are already doing natural farming for quite a number of years. So in this case, I have seen PGS India website. The farmers belong to same village or just a neighbor villages, but not from different places in a district or a mandal. So how can we handle this in this case?
See, the difficulty is, say, if they are not in one place, how do you actually ensure integrity between them or collective responsibility in them? See, the whole PGS system is based on collateral security and so collateral guarantee. So 10 people say, each one says, I am guaranteeing the rest of the 9 people. If anyone makes a mistake, I am also responsible. Right?
Okay.
So if 10 people are located in different locations, how do they verify? So that's a problem. So you understand that? So
yes, that is.
You cannot establish the collateral guarantee between people who are not located in one area. That's a problem.
Okay. As I understand that they are already doing natural farming for the past 5 years or 6 years.
Yeah. So better would be to get, say, 5 people in one location together, 5 people in one location together, and then make them into a group. Okay. And then gradually encourage them to expand.
Okay. So in this case, we...
See, what happens is any single farmer is very difficult to continue. So obviously there should be in terms of production or in terms of marketing. So somewhere there need to be an aggregation.
Yes.
So why not try in the same places? It's much easier.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sudhir, one more question, please.
Yeah.
As a PGS certification is entire 3-year process, no?
So both NPOP also is 3 years process. So
during these 3 years, may farmers cultivate several crops. So which crop will be finally certified along with the certification?
No, every season it is a certificate given. So the 3 years period is on. See, certification is always to a plot. So every year you register which crop you are growing in that particular year. So if you have 2 crops in that particular year, then you register both the crops. If you have 6 crops during that 2 year. That season, you register 6 crops.
Oh.
You get certificate for all of them.
So, is there any soil testing, water testing, or actual testing of the product done under PGS?
Both. It's a random sample test which is done. Say, 1% random sample and then test.
But who does it?
The, say, PGS Regional Council does it.
Okay.
So we collect random samples of soil and products and then we sell, we test. So like that. So likewise, any agency will do.
Sir, please, can you say about the organic processing facilities?
Yeah.
Value addition.
Huh. What is the question?
What are the important points that doing in processing facilities to maintain to?
So you cannot process anything else in that. So you have to do only organic, and you need to maintain the records.
Okay. Thank you.
You have to maintain the records of what you are processing all the time. So when the verification happens for certification, they will verify the product. The your entire list of. Operations in the last 1 year, and then they will look at all the details.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, any more questions? So we'll stop here then.
Sir, for example, if you start the processing of the organic products and produce, for example, jam, how easy is it to for the public to accept it, other than international brands, how easy is it for them to accept our brands?
See, that's a regular business plan which you need to make. How you get people to people accept your products? So how you sell is a completely business strategy which you need to have.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So, sir, we see that some, let's say, small brands or small companies using this natural or organic very loosely, right?
Yes.
So,
yes.
On the wrapper, let's say there is a cookie packet or a small box.
Yes.
They use it organic or natural, something like that. So, is it regulated or is it
illegal.
Monitored?
It is illegal. Oh. Whenever they catch hold of it, then they will be...
Is there any limit on the turnover, as you said, 12 lakhs?
I said 12 lakhs, yeah.
So somebody is, let's say, operating a small-scale unit with some woman, etc. If the turnover is less than 12 lakhs, can I put a natural or organic something like
that? You can, and you can sell locally only, no? Because you cannot sell in any other store and anywhere. So, they're exempted only if you are selling directly.
Okay. Directly in the sense, I obviously, retail stores, I'll give it.
No. No. So, the moment you have to sell yourself directly.
Okay. I need to... fine.
So, you cannot sell in any other... That's the point. The point is, you have to sell directly. So, if you are... have a store in your... if you are selling it directly. So, direct sales is what is exempted. It's not only 12 lakhs, but it's also direct sales.
So, direct sales to the end consumer, sir?
End consumer. Yes.
Okay. So...
Sir, farmer to end consumer, sir.
Farmer to consumer, yes.
So farmers, anyways, don't pay tax. Do you mean for the FPO then?
No, it's not only about tax. Say, if I'm selling rice, if I'm selling to the consumers, I'm exempted. But if I'm selling to another retail store, selling through another retail store or another brand, then I need to have a certificate. Say, for example, if you want to sell it in more supermarket, more supermarket cannot carry a product from you unless it is labeled and as organic. And then if it is has to be labeled as organic, it has to be certified organic.
Okay, but
so you can sell yourself. If you have your shop, you can sell. Yeah.
Without the certification.
Without the certification.
Oh. Okay.
Sir, I think it looks like the basic certification is that FSS AI certification, right?
No, see, FSSA governs the labeling laws in this country.
Okay.
Whereas certification is by either EPIDA or NCOF.
Okay.
Sir, one question, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, Naresh from Vishakhapatnam.
Yeah.
Sir, I have created a band and I was very much interested since 3 years, sir. I was following up. Yeah, sir. I'm a very big follower of you, sir. But I did not get any chance to get tied up with Sahajaram also, sir.
So we wanted to start this month, last month, and then you have seen the whole problem now. Yeah,
even marketing program also, sir. 5 days program. Yeah. Even
that also got cancelled because of all these.
Sir, things. Is there any idea to conduct 5 days online sessions?
We wanted to do this. So we will be announcing it soon. So there will be a 5-day course on both on organic production as well as on marketing. Both we will announce soon. So maybe
please,
in a couple of days we will do
please, sir.
Naresh, one of my colleagues also will call you, and then we will see how we can work in the next few months also. So even before we get into the formal marketing,
yes, sir.
Do something.
Yes, sir.
We'll discuss about it.
Yes, sir. One more thing, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I have created my brand, and instead of Sahajaram, I can create a brand.
You can buy.
Sir, can I get any support from CSA or? Sahajaram producers to support me, sir. Like, you know, I can
procure. That's what I said. You see organicmandi.co, or you can download the mobile application, and there is a list of products which are available. You can directly buy all the products.
The same cost which were in the market as like fair price.
No, whatever FPOs want, basically.
Okay.
So
okay.
It's not a processed one, no. So if you want, they can process and give you, which is a process additional cost. But the raw product, if you're buying paddy will cost as a paddy.
Okay.
Hello.
Yeah.
I'm good, Rajesh. I just wanted to ask one thing. Can a group of farmers, each farmer with an annual turnover less than 12 lakhs, sell directly to customers through FPO without certification?
That's where I said about the market platform. Say, we can have a farmer's market where each individual farmer can sell. So, you have to maintain your records separately for each individual farmer. So which it doesn't, the market doesn't carry a brand, but the individual farmer will sell directly. Say I open a shop, I open a place where people can come and sell. 10 farmers can come and put their produce and sell. Each is separate. So I bill separately.
Sir, but let's say I'm a farmer and I'm exempted up to 12 lakhs to not have a certificate, right? And I need to, and I don't
and have you sell directly to the consumer.
Yeah, and I'm selling directly to the consumer. The consumer or the opposite person that I'm selling to, he asked me for a certificate, right?
No, if you ask, then you need to produce.
See, okay.
You are exempted. See, you are exempted to
by law.
Allowed to sell if there are places for you.
Right, right. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah.
Yeah. Hi, sir. Tanmay here. One question is a no. As you said, you need to, if you want to get involved in the entire supply chain, you need to hold products like rice for 12 to 16 or 16 to 18 months. Can you explain that?
Say what happens
in a broader
is sense? Broader sense is, say if you are talking about, say, Sona Masuri fine rice, okay. It comes to harvest only once in a year. It comes to harvest only once in a year. And people only eat aged rice. So that aging process is for 6 to 8 months. So after 6 to 8 months, if you have to sell, then you need to wait till the next product comes in. So that comes to about 16 to 18 months.
Okay. And is this applicable for all cereals and other all dry produce?
No. Different products has different period, gestation period. So say red gram about 1 year.
Okay, I got it. Fine.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. So we'll close it here. Thank you very much. What we do is we will share again our contact details and other things where we can engage. We'll also send you a feedback form where you can give your feedback, which will be helpful for us in further continuing. We'll also announce 5-day course, and we are also trying to work towards setting up a ecosystem for farmers and farmers cooperatives to market their produce. So if you are interested in getting into as a food brand, if you want to get into market, you can use this ecosystem. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.